So welcome all of you to our webinar from CK Birla Hospital. I am Dr. Ratna Pratan, Consultant Pediatric Orthopedics and Sports Injuries at CK Birla Hospital, Gurugram. So today we'll be discussing a relatively common topic which you all see, especially the physical therapist and the occupational therapist. So that is clinical assessment and decision making in cerebral palsy.
So by definition, cerebral palsy was defined as a group of permanent disorders of development of movement and posture. There are three important words in the definition, which are permanent, involving the motor, posture, and it's a non-progressive disorder. To summarize it, it's a static encephalopathy. It's a static brain lesion resulting in motor impairment, and it's one of the commonest onset childhood disability. So if we shortly discuss the pathology, it is a lesion in the brain. The most common insult is during the parental period when there is a hypoxic insult to the brain of a child either because of delayed labor or because of obstructed labor or because of meconium aspiration or sometimes the baby may have problem post delivery. These kids usually have a history of NICU care. They have a history of low birth weight, preterm. So ultimately, it leads to brain damage. And the ultimate effect of this brain damage over a period of time is that the overall inhibition over the lower motor neurons are lost, and it results into various kinds of upper motor neuron type of clinical presentation. So it can be a positive presentation, can be a negative presentation. So positive are mostly in the way of spasticity, hyperreflexia, clonus, contractions of muscles. Negative are the weakness, fatigability, poor balance, sensory deficits. Ultimately, all of them leads to multiple musculoskeletal problems, especially muscle shortening, bone torsion, joint instability. These are all basically liver arm disorders because of spasticity, uncontrolled spasticity over a period of time. Now, to summarize cerebral palsy clinically, it is divided into three types. So this spastic type is the most common type, around 70-80%. Dyskinetic type is around 10-15%, and ataxic type is around 3%. Now, mixed types sometimes are seen, which has component of spasticity and dyskinesia, especially dystonia. Now, dyskinetic types can be choreoathetosis, dystonia, dysphagia, dysarthria, drooling. So why are we discussing all this? This is because as orthopedic surgeons and as therapists, we are mostly involved in treating the spastic and the dystonic types. The choreoathetoid, dysphagic and the other types, ataxic type, usually need additional neurological intervention of pediatric neurologists because they have greater brain damage. So we'll come to that later on. According to the anatomical part, the topographical classification of cerebral palsy is based on the part of the limb involved, how many limbs are involved. It can be diplegic, where the lower limbs are involved more than the upper limbs. It can be hemiplegic, where one side of the body is involved more than the other part. It can be quadriplegic or a total body type, where all four limbs are equally involved. It can be triplegic, can be monoplegic and double hemiplegic. Double hemiplegic means the upper limbs are involved more than the lower limbs. Monoplegic, a single limb is involved. Triplegic, three limbs are involved. This is an anatomical classification, helps them to decide the management and prognostication. Depending on the types of clinical impairment, can be motor, it can be non-motor. Now, among motor, they can be positive signs, they can be negative signs. The positive signs are mostly related to hypertonia or hyperkinesia. Now, there can be some negative signs which are related to weakness, poor selective control, ataxia, apraxia, dyspraxia, bradykinesia. So these are basically the negative signs. There are some non-motor signs because of the damage to the basal ganglia, to the part of the brain which controls our cognition, which controls our language, which controls our bladder. So they all need a multifaceted approach because of this myriad, clinical impairments. Now, why are we discussing all this? This is to emphasize on the fact that they usually need a multidisciplinary approach to management. We are not the only ones who will be managing cerebral palsy. So, as orthopedic surgeon and physical therapist and occupational therapist, we'll be mostly managing the spastic and the dystonic types. And there are some kinds of hyperkinesia, chorea, dystonia, acatechosis. These are, and the other clinical, non-clinical, non-motor types are mostly managed by other specialties. So we need all of, you know, care of all of them. And another important thing is spastic kids and dystonic kids, they, and the mixed types, they do well with surgical intervention. The other types with a lot of chorea, acatosis, which ultimately signify a lot of brain ganglia, basal ganglia damage, they do not well with, do well with surgery. So we avoid all types of soft tissue surgeries in kids with dystonia. That is why this classification is so important. Now to quickly summarize the type, the clinical difference between these.
Spasticity usually means if you examine a child and you see that it's not, you know, the limbs are rigid, it can either be due to spasticity, rigidity, it can be dystonia. So when you suddenly flex the limb, if you feel a sudden catch, so that is most likely a spasticity. So that spastic catch is classical of spasticity. Now, and that is also velocity dependent. The faster you bend a limb, the more resistance you'll feel. So that is classic of a spasticity. If you gradually relax the limb, you'll be able to relax it. But that is not the case in kids with dystonia. So dystonic kids will have an ill-sustained, involuntary movements of the limb. They'll they will not be responsive to the velocity. So whether you extend or flex the limb, the tone will remain same, and there'll be no spastic catch. Right, so you will won't feel the sudden resistance when you flex the limb. So that is the basic difference between spasticity and dystonia. It is very important to distinguish between them, because if we do extensive soft tissue surgical releases in a dystonic kids, they may not do well. They may even worsen clinically. Some kids have a lot of involuntary, slow, jerky, ill-sustained movements in the body, which usually are not in the control of the kids. So these kids have chorea. Chorea indicates sudden jerky involuntary movements of the body, especially the upper limbs and the perioral muscles, right, and the shoulder. In acatechosis, the child usually has a lot of slow writhing movements of involving the one part of the body, both the upper limbs and the lower limbs.
This shows the various types of brain damage in cerebral palsy. In spastic type, usually the cortical part is damaged. The dyskinetic type means mostly the basal ganglia and the putamen. These are the parts of the brain which are damaged. Ataxic type, mostly the cerebellum is damaged. And just to emphasize the type. So we'll be focusing mainly on the three types, which are the commonest type, the spastic hemiplegic, the spastic diplegic, and the spastic quadriplegic types. And the quadriplegic types are mostly non-ambulatory kids. We'll be speaking more about them. So there are various classification systems which we use to basically assess the clinical, assess the function of the kids. The most common functional classification which we use is the GMFCS function system. The GMFCS basically helps to assess the patient's ambulatory function, the use of mobility kids, mobility aids, and its performance in sitting, standing, and walking. There are two other functional mobility scale, the manual ability clinical system, which are also used. We won't be going into the depth. We'll be only discussing GMFCS because that helps in clinical decision making and helps in planning for the surgery, and also helps in prognostication. Now, if you go to the type 1 kids are usually those who are independent mostly. They can walk around, they can run, but they may have some limitation in community ambulation. So they may have limitation in speed, they may have limitation in balance and coordination, especially when running on uneven surface. So they can usually run, jump and climb stairs, except when asked to do on an uneven surface. Level 2, they may have some limitation. They can mostly walk independently, climb stairs, holding railings. But obviously, community ambulation may be difficult. They may have difficulty in balancing on uneven terrain. They can't run, they can't jump, unlike type 1. In type 3, the kids usually need handheld mobility devices and they may self-propel for short distances. Type 4 also, the kids are wheelchair bound, but they can use the wheelchairs themselves. They usually need a caretaker to take care, and they may walk short distances with orthotic support and with walking aids. In level types, level 4, level 5, the kids are totally non-ambulatory. They have to be transported on a wheelchair, on a which is carried by a caretaker. So they cannot even operate the wheelchair. That's the basic difference between 4 and 5. So they have poor leg and arm movements. They have poor head control. So basically, anti-gravity muscles are not functioning. They have poor tone. So basically, they need orthotic supports. They need a CP chair to be able to make them sit. So this is the functional mobility scale also used. We won't be going into the detail. And that's the manual abilities classification system used to assess the upper limb function. We won't be going into the detail. We'll be only focusing on the clinical part. So on if a kid comes to you, you know, with their parent saying that, you know, so-and-so kid has a difficulty in walking. So what history should we take? The most important history which we all ask is any difficulty in the perinatal period. That means delayed in labor, prolonged labor, in any history of preterm birth, any history of perinatal asphyxia, any history of NICU admission, any history of intubation required time of birth, any history of delayed cry. These are important history which may indicate that yes, there might have been a hypoxic insert at the time of birth. That's the single most important history which is important. Now, sometimes patients may give history of prolonged jaundice, which may signify that patient may have had a history of conjunctivitis, which may have damaged the basal ganglia. So these kids again have a poor prognosis because of a lot of dyskinetic movements, dystonia, atherosclerosis, because of basal ganglia involved. Now, grown-up kids will obviously give history, the parents will give history of delayed milestones, as in the child may not gain, you know, the head control by 2 months, they may not be sitting by 6 months, they may not be standing by 1 year, 11 months to 1 year, they may not be running by 18 months. So, these again will be an indirect indicator of probable brain damage and likely cerebral palsy. But you know, clinically to diagnose cerebral palsy is really difficult because in early years, especially first 2 years, we'll only get history of delayed milestones. You know, and one more important thing is early hand dominance. If a mother says that, you know, he uses his right hand or the left hand to pick things, to hold a teddy. And that's also an indicator because hand dominance usually develops after 4 or 5 years of age. If that develops early, that may be an indication that the opposite limb may be involved or the musculoskeletal tone may not be normal, so that, you know, which impairs the holding, the grip power. That these are important history findings, which is important, right? Then you also assess the family's resources, whether they'll be able to, you know, take care of the baby, the you know, the financials as well, because sometimes they may not afford the treatment for long. So all that is very important in decision making. So these are the basic points in clinical examination. So the three main headings are the neurological examination, musculoskeletal examination, and the functional examination. So the neurological part will include the assessment of the higher mental functions, the assessment of the cranial nerves, the assessment of the motor power, the assessment of the sensory function, assessment of reflexes, assessment of the gait. It's a part of neurological examination, which is very important. With this help, this assessment of the baby in totality. Now, musculoskeletal examination is a detailed thing. We'll be going into each of them. Then functional examination also is very important. Among the musculoskeletal part, there are several things to be examined. This is the diagnostic grid. So X-ray examination, then assessment of the GMFCS level, the functional motor mobility scale, and the sagittal gait pattern. So these are basic assessments which we all do in cerebral palsy kit, no matter what type it is. Right, so you must remember this one slide to assess a kid. That is very important. Now, X-rays specifically, I won't be going into the details of the X-ray. Only remember that X-ray pelvis and knee. These are two important X-rays which are important to assess a child, especially to assess the hip and to assess the level of patella. Right, these are the only X-rays which are routinely done. We'll come to that. The musculoskeletal examination will include assessment of spasticity, contracture, deformity. It has to be done in a calm ambience. It has to be done. It should assess the range of motion of hip, knee, and ankle. It should assess the spine. It should assess the pelvic obliquity. It should assess the limb length discrepancy. Spasticity, of course,
leads in long term leads to inhibition of muscle growth, which ultimately leads to contracture, liver arm dysfunction, and loss of function and locomotility. These are two scales which are used to assess these, to grade these plasticity. Now, to us, to assess the functional assessment includes sitting balance. Sitting, a child can be independent sitter, can be a hand dependent sitter, can be a propped sitter. So this will assess the trunk balance, see whether the child has reasonable trunk power. That is why sitting ability is very important. Now, if a child is non-ambulatory, we'll see various hypertonic muscle groups, the attitude, the windswept attitude of the hip, the flex attitude of the knee, the calcaneus deformity at the ankle. So these are classic findings in a non-ambulatory kid. Second thing we examine is balance. Balance is examined to assess the extent of ataxia in the kid, because the spastic kids, if they have cerebellar damage, may have difficulty in balancing. So we can ask the kid to stand on one foot. We can ask them to hop on one leg. We can ask them to do a Romberg sign, which is like closing the eyes and standing on foot, and ask them to just stand. So they may fall off. So they have poor proprioception and hence poor balance. Now, gait assessment is very important. Observational gait analysis is a very important part of cerebral palsy, and we all should know in detail about all this. There are four basic types: true equinus, jump gait, parent equinus, and a crouch gait. So in a true equinus, the hip and knees is usually extended, the ankle is an equinus. In jump gait, the hip and knee are in flexion, and there is equinus at the ankle. In parent equinus, there is no true equinus, but yes, hip and knee is in flexion. And in crouch gait, this is the worst type, the most disabling type, where there is excessive hip flexion, knee flexion, there's a lot of scissoring because of adductor spasticity, and there's excessive dorsiflexion. So basically, the foot goes into calcaneus. So these are the two phases of gait which we assess during gait cycle. And there are three rockers. I think we should know about this. I'll be sending you the PDF. Now, to quickly go through the important types, the most important type clinically is the jump gait and the crouch gait. Clinically, most of the kids will be in either of these two groups, right? Now, a jump gait kid will have an ankle in equinus, a knee in flexion, and hip in flexion, but their balance will relatively be good. And these kids will start off with a 4-foot rocker and will end up walking extremely fast so that they do not fall. This is because when the child starts walking, so the child first puts his weight on the forefoot, the metatarsal heads. And that creates a ground reaction force which quickly passes anterior to the knee, which helps in extending the knee. So basically, the plantar flexion and this knee extension couple acts together, and that helps to propel the kids, that helps to extend, keep the knee in extension. So that prevents buckling of the knee. That's how the jump gait happens, and these kids usually will be seen to jump around literally. They give up relatively fast. Now, a crouch gait kid will have the opposite. So there is no plantar flexion, there is dorsiflexion, that is a calcaneus deformity at the ankle. So these kids won't be able to walk fast. This is because here, the ground reaction force goes anterior to the knee when the child walks in the mid-stance phase. Now here, as the child lands on the foot, you know, in the mid-stance phase, the ground reaction force here, the ground reaction force is actually going from here posterior to the knee, right? So this ultimately acts to flex the knee. So there is no plantar flexion because of the calcaneus, and there is no extensor movement. So the ultimate effect is the hip and the knee both flexes instead of extending during the swing phase, and the ankle of course does not plantar flex. So the plantar flexion knee extension couple is lost, right? So they have a very poor gait, they can hardly walk, and they usually land up in a vicious cycle where the foot further goes to calcaneus and the planovalgus, the knee further flexes and the hip further flexes. So these cases usually require extensive surgical procedures to correct the deformity and to normalize the gait. And jump gait kids do well because they need lesser amount of surgeries. Now crouch gait, as I explained, the weight, the ground reaction force goes posterior to the knee. This is the normal biomechanics. This is how the crouch gait happens. So ultimately the knee flexes. So this results in three types of knee patterns: jump knee, crouch knee, stiff knee, and recurvatum knee. Stiff and recurvatum knee have very tight rectus femoris. So we need to assess the kid in the swing phase. We'll be seeing less of knee flexion. So these kids will be having stiff knee. So if we assess the child in a sagittal way, we'll see that there is inadequate knee flexion in the swing phase. So these kids will need a rectus release or a rectus transfer. That is why, you know, different knee patterns, the gait patterns are so important to assess, so that we can, you know, clinically decide where to, you know, put our effort on, where to, you know, put Botox, where to stretch, which muscles to stretch, how to position the kids. Now, hip examination, of course, is very important to assess the iliopsoas tightness, because flexion deformity at the hip is mostly because of the tightness of the iliopsoas. This is how we assess the flexion deformity at the hip. We flex the opposite hip. The angle the ipsilateral thigh makes with the couch is the flexion deformity at the hip. So if we see that on both sides, that means the iliopsoas is tight. Now we test the adduction. Spasticity is because of this tightness of the adductor longus. So we do the adduction test in hip flexion as well as in extension. So when we are doing it in flexion, we are basically examining the adductor longus. When we are doing it in extension, we are basically examining the gracilis along with adductor longus. So what we do is we give sudden abductor force at the hip and look for these catch. So in spastic muscles, as I said, you'll feel a catch. So the first angle which we see is the R1, and the second, if we continue the pressure, the second stop which we feel is the R2. So we calculate the R1 and R2 in every muscle groups which we examine. So adductor, hamstrings, the gastrosoleus, everywhere we look for the R1 and the R2. So that basically estimates the level of spasticity. Now, Ellis-Duncan test is for the rectus tightness. We ask the child to lie prone, we flex the knee, and we look for the lift of the pelvis from the couch. So this shows that the rectus is tight, because the rectus is a biarticulum. It crosses the hip joint. Now, femoral antiversion is another big problem, because these kids, as you all know, they walk with a lot of intoeing. This doing is because of inadequate remodeling of the, you know, the antiversion of the kids. The normal antiversion at the time of birth doesn't remodel to a normal version. So these kids tend to walk with an intoeing gait, and because of that, the tibia ultimately goes into external torsion. So these are very important lever arm dysfunctions that lead to multiple problems in the body of a child. Now, to assess it, basically we ask the child to lie prone. We see the rotation at which the trochanter is maximally prominent, and that the angle which the leg makes with the vertical is the angle of the antiversion. Now, this signifies the lever arm dysfunction which I was explaining. We examine the hip rotations. This is the internal rotation, this is the external rotation, that is also examined in prone position. So, internal rotation will exaggerate it. Internal rotation shows that the hip is in antiversion. Now, the patella level is also very important. We very commonly see patella alta, so we need to examine further. Now, we see the hamstring contracture. The hamstring tightness is assessed by the popliteal angle. So, when we examine in one foot, so basically the hip and knee is flexed, and we try and extend the knee. So the angle the leg makes with the vertical is the popliteal angle. So when we do it on one side, it's unipopliteal angle. It's called unilateral popliteal angle. When we flex the opposite head, this is to nullify the lumbar lordosis. So this is the bilateral popliteal angle. Basically, it is to assess the hamstring tightness. So we need to know the fixed flexion deformity at the knee. So that basically assesses the posterior capsular contracture at the knee. So we lie the child on the edge of the table. We extend the hip. This is how we examine the flexion deformity at the knee. Silver skull test basically differentiates between the gastrocnemius tightness and the soleus tightness. Most of the cerebral palsy kids, gastrocnemius is more tight, soleus is really tight. So we will be able to flex the ankle, dorsiflex the ankle when we flex it, but we won't, when we extend the knee, we won't be able to
dorsiflexion. That signifies gastrocnemius tractus. Now the thigh foot angle shows the amount of tibial torsion. So if the child is lying prone, we assess the angle between the foot and the thigh. This shows the thigh foot angle. Normally it is around 15 degrees, 10 to 15 degrees. If it is exaggerated, that means the patient has an exaggerated tibial torsion, external tibial torsion. So this is a case of external tibial torsion. This torsion problem should be corrected early. Why am I emphasizing on this clinical examination? Because torsion problem should be corrected earlier. These are bony corrections which should ideally be done between 4 to 5 years of age if it is more than normal, because long-term effects can be really detrimental. Now, this is another way of measuring the tibial torsion. There is an angle between the line through the femoral condyles and through the bimalleolus, the medial and the lateral malleolus. So the angle between them is the bimalleolar axis. The angle between them measures the bimalleolar axis angle. This is another way of measuring the external tibial torsion. Now, as we go down, we examine the foot for varus, valgus, the crossover toe, the other various foot deformities which we get. Now, upper limbs are also involved in cerebral palsy. There are various kinds of upper limb involved. We are not going into the detail of each of them, but in short, mostly the kids have a flexion deformity at the elbow. The shoulder is in adductors, the forearm is pronated, the wrist is flexed, the thumb is in palm, basically the thumb is in adduction, the fingers are flexed. These are the common deformities which we see in cerebral palsy kids, and they usually respond to various kinds of therapy, either Botox or stretching or splinting, or sometimes they may need tendon transfers. So we'll be going through those parts later on. Now hip surveillance is very important because these kids have very high incidence of head dysplasia because of the imbalance at the hip. The hip is normally seated at within the socket at birth, but because of the muscle imbalance, because of the saturated antiversion, because of the coxa valga, the hip gradually grows out of the socket. So hip surveillance is very important. Now there are various techniques which have been described. There are various schemes. The American Academy of Cerebral Palsy has a protocol for examining the hip. We should be following it. Clinical examination does not always correlate with a well located hip. So we really need X-ray pelvis depending on the GMFCS level. So this is how the hip is in a dysplastic hip. This is how we correct the hip. So these are the lines which we draw during clinical assessment and on a X-ray pelvis. These are the Perkins line, the Huggins, the Hilgenrinus lines. So what we're interested in, this. We need to calculate the migration percentage. So in a GMFCS 1 or 2 years, every 2 years we need to get an X-ray pelvis and need to assess if the head is going out. If the migration percentage, migration Remus index is more than 30%, that means more than 30% of the head is out of this line, Perkins line, that means the hip is unstable, is getting dysplastic, and it will further go out. Ultimately, these hip will dislocate. So initially it will be subluxed, it may gradually dislocate over a period of time. So we need to calculate migration percentage sequentially in all the X-ray pelvis. So this is what American Academy says. This shows the GMFCS levels, this is the age. We don't need to remember them. It's a chart which has to be pasted in the clinic. So in our GMFCS 1, we do clinical examination at 1, at 2 years, 4 years and 6 years. GMFCS 2 at 2 years, 4 years and 6 years. Along with that, we add an X-ray. This is an indication for an X-ray. Now imagine the 4 and 5. So we are literally getting a clinical examination and an X-ray every year. So this is to emphasize the importance of X-rays in a GMFCS 4 and 5. Always these non-ambulatory kids have a very high risk of hip subluxation and hip dislocation, and they may end up having a lot of difficulty because of difficulty in perineal care, difficulty in sitting, dislocated heads causing a lot of problems. So these, unless we have a high index of suspicion, we may miss it, and the patients may land up with only salvageable therapies. So these are the kinds of surgeries which we do. We basically cut the proximal femur and try and give a varus to the proximal femur. We do a pelvic osteotomy to increase the coverage on the proximal femur. So this is to contain the hip. So this is the final result.